أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم ربنا إني أسكنت من ذريتي بواد غير ذي زرع عند بيتك المحرم ربنا ليقيموا الصلاة فاجعل أفئدة من الناس تهوي إليهم وارزقهم من الثمرات لعلهم يشكرون ربنا إنك تعلم ما نخفي وما نعلن وما يخفى على الله من شيء في الأرض ولا في السماء الحمد لله الذي وهب لي على الكبر إسماعيل وإسحاق إن ربي لسميع الدعاء رب اجعلني مقيم الصلاة ومن ذريتي ربنا وتقبل دعاء ربنا اغفر لي ولوالدي وللمؤمنين يوم يقوم الحساب رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. Once again, everyone, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. We continue with the dua of Ibrahim alayhi salam. In his old age, the last thing I shared with you is he said, whoever follows me is considered from my family, is part of me, فَإِنَّهُ مِنِّي. And whoever were to disobey me, that certainly you are forgiving, always loving, caring, and merciful. He then says, رَبَّنَا إِنِّي أَسْكَنْتُ مِنْ ذُرِّيَّةِ بِوَادٍ غَيْرِ ذِي زَرْعٍ. My master, our master, I have certainly settled part of my family, part of my offspring, in a valley that doesn't produce any green, any vegetation. He's referring to Mecca. And he didn't settle all of his family there, part of his family, min dhurriyati. And dhurriya also means that they're supposed to have children and their children are supposed to have children. Dhurriya doesn't just mean children, it means generations. Meaning I've instructed my son that I've settled here, that he's going to live here, have children here, and his children will remain, and they're not going to leave this place. You know, when you're living in a place that has a harsh environment, and, you know, for economic reasons, for political reasons, for social reasons, you might say, well, one day my son will grow up and maybe they'll move out of here and go somewhere else and live somewhere else. Of course, we're living in a global world now. People are moving all the time for all kinds of reasons. But Ibrahim alayhi salam, by using the word dhurriya here, is suggesting that I have made sure that my family remains settled here and will stay here. And this is why Ismail alayhi salam was there, and thousands of years later, from his lineage, you get Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they don't move from that place. So, إِنِّي أَسْكَنْتُ مِنْ ذُرِّيَّةِ بِوَادٍ غَيْرِ ذِي زَرْعٍ عِنْدَ بَيْتِكَ الْمُحَرَّمِ, in the proximity of your sacred sanctified house. This is the only reason I moved them here, is because of your instruction. And notice, you know, the way that he settled his family there is important to mention. He didn't just bring his family there and there was a convenient city and they said, well, this is your house and you live here. That's not how that happened. Allah instructed him to leave his wife and child in the middle of the desert when there was nothing there, and not even water there yet, no humanity there, and he left. And he doesn't turn to Allah and say, Ya Allah, remember when I left my family here because you asked me? He doesn't put it that way. He said, أَسْكَنْتُ مِنْ ذُرِّيَّةِ بِوَادٍ غَيْرِ ذِي زَرْعٍ. I settled my family down in a valley that doesn't have any, you know, in a valley that doesn't produce any green, doesn't have any vegetation. In other words, he used soft language with Allah. Even when you go through harsh experiences, you learn the manners of speaking with Allah from Ibrahim alayhi salam. Ibrahim alayhi salam has gone through some of the most difficult experiences a human being can ever go through. And when he talks to Allah, you have to keep in mind that he's gone through all of these rough experiences, and yet this is the way he speaks with Allah. So he says, all of this I did, رَبَّنَا لِيُقِيمُ الصَّلَاةِ. Master, we did all of that so they would establish the prayer. This is at the end of his life. He's now, you know, passed all of the tests. The Kaaba has already been built. And now he understands that all of that test was there so one day this Kaaba could be built. So they could establish the prayer. Obviously, the building of the Kaaba and the establishing of the prayer are directly connected to each other. So he says, now I understand why you put me through those trials. رَبَّنَا لِيُقِيمُ الصَّلَاةِ. Not only so that I establish the prayer, so my children and their children and their children and their children continue to establish the prayer. This is again the mindset of Ibrahim alayhi salam that I'd like for us to know. Allah doesn't just want us to become people that establish this prayer. He wants us to raise the kind of children that will think about themselves and about their next generations. It's not enough that you and I are attending in a masjid, or you and I are learning something about Islam, or you and I are tuning in and reminding ourselves of something about the Quran. What's going to happen 20 years from now? What's going to happen 30 years from now? You know, as generations go by, the scary thing is there are so many other religions in the world, across the religions of the world actually, next generations are losing their religious identity. You know, the next generation doesn't keep the religious identity of their forefathers. When in the 90s, when I went to college, in sociology studies, we were studying the Orthodox neighborhoods in New York City. The Jewish community in New York City, who the next generation of Jewish youth are actually less and less committed to the faith. They don't observe the same dress code, they don't observe the same, you know, worship and all of that stuff, so they're losing their population. There are big churches across the East Coast, not so much in the South, but across the East Coast, there are massive churches that are now nightclubs or have been turned into something else because the next generation didn't come. And this is for people whose religion is way easier. Right, their religion is—it's not demanding like the religion of the Deen of Allah that demands the kind of, you know, submission that our Deen demands. The kind of fight against temptation for young people to submit to Islam while they're going through college, or while they're even going through high school or middle school for that matter, is not easy. But in spite of all of that, for us to maintain the next generation and the next generation and make sure that they are going to be those who carry this Deen properly, this is a very powerful thing. So he asks Allah Azza wa Jal, he makes dua to Allah, or he reminds himself that, Ya Allah, you put me through these trials, not just for me and these kids right here, not just Ismail who passed the test with me, but this, the blessing of this will go on for many generations. رَبَّنَا لِيُقِيمُ الصَّلَىٰ فَاجْعَلْ أَفْئِدَةً مِّنَ النَّاسِ تَهْوِي إِلَيْهِمْ. Really powerful. Because they established the prayer, this is called الفاء السببية, therefore make hearts of people soft towards them. Meaning my future generation of children, Ya Allah, make all nations, all people have a soft heart towards my children because they establish the prayer and take care of the Kaaba. Because of that reason. And so, my children, you know, otherwise, I don't want my children to be popular among humanity, but the only reason people should have a soft corner towards them is because they take care of your house. Now, these ayat, which is the dua of Ibrahim alayhi salam, were given to us in Surah Ibrahim. Interestingly enough, the name of the surah is also Surah Ibrahim. And this is towards the end of the surah. And the surah very clearly reminds us, the Prophet ﷺ, that the Quraysh are not taking care of the Kaaba and the religion of the Kaaba they were supposed to. They surrounded it with idols. They changed the religion of Ibrahim ﷺ. And they are being reminded of the dua of their father. You know, the Quraysh were the most popular of the Arabs of the entire region. Everybody respected them, and they only respected them for one reason. Because they took care of the Kaaba. That's why they respected them. And now Allah is reminding them, the only reason they respect you is because your father had made a dua that their heart should be soft towards you. But their heart should only be soft towards you because you established the prayer. لِيُقِيمُ الصَّلَاةَ فَاجْعَلْ أَفْئِدَةً مِّنَ النَّاسِ تَهْوِي إِلَيْهِمْ وَارْزُقْهُمْ مِّنَ الثَّمَرَاتِ. And provide them all kinds of fruit. People would come there from all kinds of regions after doing trade, and they would stop over in Mecca, and when they would stop, they would bring fruits from all different places. They get imported food like nobody else. And notice even the dua of Ibrahim alayhi salam. First he says, this house was built for what fundamental purpose? So they establish the prayer. That's the first rizq. That's the most important provision from Allah, that they take care of their iman, their hearts. That's with the prayer. Then after that, because their hearts are connected to Allah, Ya Allah, I want them to become a sadaqah jariyah, a continued charity for other people who will be inspired to get closer to Allah when they're in their proximity, soften other people's hearts towards them. That's their second rizq. Meaning when they come before Allah on Judgment Day, their own prayers will help them, and the fact that they helped others connect to Allah will help them too. أَدَّلُوا عَلَى الْخَيْرِ كَفَاعِلِهِ, like the Prophet says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The one who points to something good, the one who inspires you to do something good, they get the same reward as you doing the good. And that's the second piece of rizq that he asked for them. Then the third piece is, Ya Allah, provide them all kinds of fruit because they clearly don't have any fruit. وَعَدٍ غَيْرِ ذِي زَرَعٍ. They're not going to get any fruit of their own. So they should get provision from outside. Don't make them worry about making money, going out and making money.
make them so that they don't have to worry about, you know, food and drink, so they can just take care of your house and inspire people to worry to worship. Remove the worldly concern from them. And that's actually why you have, later on in Quran, Allah describes, you know, فَلْيَعْبُدُوا رَبَّ هَذَا الْبَيْتِ in Surah Quraysh, إِلَى فِيهِمْ رِحْلَةَ الشِّتَاءِ وَالصَّيْفِ, when they had the most convenient economics, and they had the most convenient trade of all the other Arabs, the only reason things were made so easy for them is because of that house. It's because Allah wanted them to concern themselves only with the worship of Allah and inspiring others to worship. And this was the original prayer of Ibrahim alayhi salam for them. And finally, لَعَلَّهُمْ يَشْكُرُونَ. All of that, hopefully they'll become grateful. They will be grateful people. And this is the summary of the other side of it. We learned before, Ibrahim alayhi salam told us, the only thing that will matter before Allah is someone who has a sound, healthy heart. Now we're learning the secret to a sound, healthy heart. Gratitude. Ya Allah, give them all of this that I'm asking for my future generations. One thing I want out of them, they should become grateful people. لَعَلَّهُمْ يَشْكُرُونَ. Hopefully they will become grateful. They will become grateful for prayer, that they are gifted enough to have the gift of prayer. They'll be grateful enough that others find solace and comfort in them. Others, they become a source of guidance for other people. Because they're custodians of Allah's house, they will remind others what it means to worship Allah. And then of course on top of that, Allah is their provider, and these are the reasons they will become grateful. لَعَلَّهُمْ يَشْكُرُونَ. What are we learning from that? The most important value that I can give my children before I die is that they can be grateful. Because if they are grateful, their heart will always be at ease. They will always look at the positive. They won't focus on the negative. And they'll always have a reason to say Alhamdulillah. And so long as they can say that, then they have the essence of Allah's book. This is why it begins that way. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. That is the most important thing, the most valuable asset. Look at the culture that we've become a part of. I mean, I talk to teenagers about this, even though I was this way, but you know, when kids become a little bit older, they're just in this whatever zone. No, whatever good happens, yeah, whatever. How's the food? Eh, whatever. How's the movie? Whatever. You want to go pray? Whatever. You know what whatever means? I'm not impressed. I'm not grateful for that. I'm entitled. And it's not good enough for me, but I'll have to make do. You know, that's the antithesis of being shakir, of being grateful. And that's inculcated early on. If your children are younger than teenagers, and you're constantly giving them and giving them and giving them, and they're not appreciating what it means to, you know, to have a blessing, then they become entitled. And the moment you don't buy them the newest video game, or the moment you don't get them the new Lego set, or the moment you don't, you know, spoil them a little more, they're like, hey, why am I not getting this? What happened here? You know, and they get an attitude. Down to the kind of iftar we're feeding our kids at the end of the day. You know, hey, where's the ketchup? I don't want this. I'm not in the mood for it. Forget it, I don't want to eat. You know, can you imagine Ibrahim alayhi salam, Ismail alayhi salam, in that day and age, they're being offered zamzam. No, 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 where's the Pepsi? That's not going to happen. لَعَلَّهُمْ يَشْكُرُونَ. Whatever comes your way, you're grateful. That we become grateful people. This is a very powerful value to have and very difficult to have in a material society. Extremely difficult to get, you know, to become grateful. I know it'll take a little bit of time, but I just want to share a story with you. I am just so moved by this. I'll tell you the rest of the story tomorrow. I'll tell you the first part of the story today. I was in Dubai, and then I was in Bahrain just last week. And one of my habits is when I take a taxi, I talk to the cab driver. You get the best stories from them. And this guy, he was an Uber driver, and they had this. He has this arrangement with the guy who owns the car, that the guy, he pays him a monthly salary. So he doesn't make money off the Uber rides. He makes a salary, and all the money goes to the owner of the car. And he says, you know, sometimes I get a ride without the Uber, like I get a side ride, 500, 1,000, but I pay every penny to him. And I was like, why do you pay every penny? He just wants the Uber money. He goes, no, 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 I don't want any extra money. I was like, why not? He goes, because I learned a lesson when I was young. I was like, what's the lesson that you learned when you were young? And he goes, I learned a lesson from a plate. And this guy, he was a Pakistani fellow. He lives in a small village on the border of Pakistan and Afghanistan. Okay, don't get me questioned later. But the guy, you know, but he lives in this village. And he's like, yeah, I learned a lesson when I was like 10 years old from a plate. I was like, I need to know this lesson. You need to tell me about this. So he says, when I was young, I went to go get naan from the local, you know, the bread from the local restaurant. And I'm sitting there, and the guy gave me the naan. I'm sitting there and eating it, and I really liked the plate. So I stole it. And I went home and I put it under my pillow. And for 3 days, I didn't tell anyone that I had this plate. And then 3 days later, when my mom made food, I brought out the plate. And I have 9 brothers and sisters. And they're all sitting there eating on the mat, and I've got a plate. And everybody, all my siblings are looking at me like, hey, where you got that plate? That's nice. I'll tell you the rest of the story later, but hold on a second. This guy's life has changed. All his siblings are going crazy because of what? Because he's got a plate. Because that's an amazing thing to him. I'm amazed just by that part of the story. You know? And everybody else, I wish I had a plate like that. You know? And he's, you know, older than me, the fellow. And he remembers the story from 10. I'll tell you the rest of it tomorrow. Keep you interested, inshallah. But the point is, لَعَلَّهُمْ يَشْكُرُونَ. Look at, in his life, what is he grateful for? What amazes him? And what have we turned into? What have we turned into? Like, things are breaking in our home, and like, dad will get another one. It's okay. There's more than that. Hey, how much were the groceries? Only $150, Abba? That's it? That's pretty cheap nowadays. This is how our kids talk now. How is this لَعَلَّهُمْ يَشْكُرُونَ? And when we turn to Allah in dua, رَبَّنَا إِنَّكَ تَعْلَمُ مَا نُخْفِي وَمَا نُعْلِنْ وَمَا يَخْفَى عَلَى اللَّهِ مِنْ شَيْءٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَلَا فِي السَّمَاءِ. Master, you know what we show, you know what we hide. Nothing is hidden from Allah, not in the earth, not in the sky. This is his dua to Allah, Ibrahim alayhi salam's dua to Allah. Why is he saying that? He knows what he's accomplished. He knows the test that he has passed. He knows what he had to go through inside and out. But he knows, Ya Allah, you know the secrets that go inside me that I don't even know myself. You know my flaws better than even I know myself. Ibrahim alayhi salam acknowledges to Allah that there are secrets that I may not even be aware of. And that for you and me, it's even worse. We're not even anywhere near Ibrahim alayhi salam. There are things in our, you know, in our deeds, there are things that go on in our hearts and our thoughts that Allah knows. The darkest thoughts that you had, that if your best friend knew, your family knew, they'd be like, you have these thoughts? You? Astaghfirullah. You know, Allah knows that you've had those thoughts. Allah knows that those temptations run in your mind. And you just turn to Allah and say, Ya Allah, nothing is hidden from you. Nothing is hidden from you. Not in the earth, nor in the sky. And that also means the deeds I do on this earth and the value they have in the sky. None of that is hidden from you. وَمَا يَخْفَى عَلَى اللَّهِ مِنْ شَيْءٍ. Hey, tickly guy, stop it. And so the last thing, inshaAllah ta'ala, before I close today, Alhamdulillah الَّذِي وَهَبَ عَلَى الْكِبَرِ وَهَبَ لِي عَلَى الْكِبَرِ إِسْمَعِيلَ وَإِسْحَاقِ إِنَّ رَبِّي لَسَمِيعُ الدُّعَى. I thank, you know, he thanks Allah and praises Allah that despite my old age, Allah gave me Ismail and Ishaq, despite my old age. Now, just think about how Allah gave him Ismail. And think about how Allah Azza wa Jalla, when he gave him Ismail, what did Allah ask him to do? You know? And first of all, he gets him at an old age. On top of getting him finally at an old age, he tells him to slaughter him when he's old enough to run around. فَلَمَّا بَلَغَ مَعَهُ السَّعْيَ. As soon as he gets old enough to run around, he asked him to slaughter him. But he doesn't remember any of that when talking to Allah. He doesn't say, remember Allah when you asked me to slaughter my own son? Well, I tried. I passed it. He says, Alhamdulillah, you granted me children. Despite my old age, I didn't even deserve kids. That's his attitude. Not the tests, but Ya Allah, what you gave me, I didn't even deserve it. And you gave it to me. That's his mentality. I'm reminded of, you know, a story my teacher told me, and this is the last thing I share with you for the day, is what these children are a responsibility, but they are a gift we don't deserve. At the same time, these children, they're not a burden. They are a gift we do not deserve. There was a fellow whose son, 18 years old, graduating from, you know, from school, on his way home in the motorcycle, dies in the car accident. The only son they had. You know, and the news doesn't, and they're waiting for their son to get home, and they're going to go to the graduation ceremony, and it's a happy day of their life, and they get the news that their son is no more. And, you know, the both parents, they just went into deep depression. They're not coming out of the house, they're not talking to anybody. You know, they're just completely paralyzed and silent at the janazah prayer. The mother's constantly crying, not even saying a word. And after some days, her husband went to her and said, you know, I've been thinking, 18 years ago, Allah gave us this beautiful gift, this toy that we got to play with, that brought us joy in our life. We didn't deserve it, and Allah gave it to us. And then after 18 years, Allah took back what was His. And instead of thanking him for those beautiful years, all we're doing is complain. This is the attitude of a slave. Yes, we miss our children if they go. What greater pain than that the loss of a child? But understanding something, we don't deserve our beautiful children. We don't deserve them. This was something given by Allah Azza wa Jal. Alhamdulillah alladhi wahaba li ala al-kibar Ismaila wa Ishaq. Inna Rabbi la sami'u ad-du'a. My master, he hears the du'a. Put that all now in the context of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He's reciting these ayat. Quraysh are listening, and they are also hearing that Ibrahim alayhi salam's du'as always get heard. And our father Ibrahim made du'a alayhi salam that his children will establish the prayer. And they're listening to this and thinking, but we're not establishing the prayer. We're the ones that are establishing shirk in the Kaaba. This is putting them to shame, reminding them, be true to the legacy of your father. You know, and Allah will not let his du'a go astray. His du'a will not be wasted. If Allah, after all that old age, gave him children that will carry his legacy, you think this coming of the Prophet ﷺ is going to go to waste? No, it will fulfill the legacy of Ibrahim alayhi salam, and that's what we're going to get to inshallah ta'ala in tomorrow's du'a. Barakallahu li wa lakum. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh.